Investor sentiment drifted this shortened trading week as the Bangko Sentral kept rates ready and steady 1 week after the Fed held its own. Philippine stocks fell for four straight days, while the Philippine peso weakened to 46.70 against the dollar. Well, joining us now for his overview on the markets and the economy is Cosio, the president at First Metro Asset Management. Good to have you with us here on a holiday, Gus. Oh. I love the shirt and the hat, the cap here. It's all red.
I took it out.
People might
not take me seriously.
Well, we're really glad to have you here on a day after the Bangko Sentral kept rates steady. No surprises there, but it happens just 1 week after the Fed kept rates steady as well. How does it change the interest rate landscape in the next couple of months until the end of this year, perhaps the first half of next year?
Personally, I think the BSP has a lot of room, but you know, the BSP has really been very conservative over the last, not just few months, but few years. They've been very careful. I think, I've heard some of the monetary board members as the operational word is macroprudential policy.
I heard that as well when I talked to the governor, and I had to ask what it meant. Well, but he did say it was maybe increasing the reserve requirements if inflation fell way below the target range.
I think it would be the other way around. Mm-hmm. If inflation fell below the target range, They would probably ease the reserve requirements.
Correct.
Because that would be the, the additional liquidity is not going to fuel any additional inflation.
Would that be one of the considerations until the end of this year?
Well, personally, you know, it would be a speculation on my part. But if it is something that I want to happen, yes, it's something that I want to happen.
But what should an investor do? I mean, if that were one of the risks, so to speak, until the end of this year, how should they position
well,
at this
that,
point?
Well, that to my mind would be upside risk, i.e., you know, the Philippine market remains resilient. Over the last few months, we've seen an exodus of foreign funds, bringing our market to more reasonable levels. I mean, for equities, that is. For interest rates, you know, I mean, interest rates are going to remain relatively low for quite some years to come. You know, it's not going back to the old level. So, that being the case, I think if you were an investor, you would really want to have some equity weight in your portfolio
at this time.
I mean,
there's so much volatility out there, and when you take a look at the valuations, and I know that you've made a presentation showing that valuations mm-hmm. are really looking reasonable across the region, but we haven't really fallen by much. So you can make the argument that we're probably still overvalued.
Fallen from a level of 8,200, I think 8,100.
Yeah, thereabouts. And we're about 6,700.
My theory is this: okay, if we were overvalued at the end of 2014, mm-hmm. we were at, I think, 7,230. If we were overvalued, and let's say we were overvalued by 10%, okay? So that would, you would readjust your year-end level to about 6.5 to 6.6 level. And that was where the market corrected about a month and a half ago, if you remember. Mm-hmm. The PSE went down to about 6.6, then it bounced from there.
And that was when China devalued its currency,
That's
right?
when China, well, Correct. A few days after China mm-hmm. devalued its currency. So, you know, I mean, we can see that the reasonableness of that level, the 6.6 level. And if you factor in the PSE's earnings growth over the first half, that was about 10-11%. You know, you should be somewhere about 6.9, 6.950, and that's where we are right now.
Yes, I was just going to say that. That's where we're treading,
and that's
it
where
seems
we're treading.
Like it's a conundrum. We're not going any higher. We're not going any lower. So why should be equity weighted at this point in time?
Well, essentially because one, we know where investors are willing to take risk, which is, you know, on or about 6,900 at the PSE. At that level, I think our earnings valuation be, you know, around 17.5, which is not so bad considering that, you know, the scarce factor in markets right now is growth, and we are, you know, one of maybe two or three economies that are growing above the 5% and possibly above 6% in the second half of this year.
True, but we also are thinking about the dollar strength, the continued dollar strength,
yes.
which is bringing down the peso, which is also an upside risk, wouldn't you say?
Yes. Well, see, the thing is, the dollar has been strong, but if you look at the peso in comparison to our neighbors, you know, I mean, we depreciated somewhere around the 1.9% for the year, whereas our neighbors have been depreciating about 3%, even a bit higher. You know, I mean, for Malaysia, for example, I think they depreciated about 6%. So the peso has been keeping its value, and why is that? You know, net foreign assets of the government has been growing. I mean, of the country, our international reserves fairly steady and growing. We are one of the very few countries in the world that have a structural current account surplus,
which also makes us ready for ASEAN integration, in a way, but not in all aspects, but in terms of an investor. When you do make that investment and become equity invested, you do have to think about the competition that is included in that ASEAN integration that we will be coming into at the start of the year.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm not a big expert on ASEAN integration. I mean, I've participated in some.
But in
ASEAN
terms of exporters, perhaps in terms of the consumer.
In terms of consumer,
yes,
you know,
companies that can benefit from this.
We are the second largest consumer country in ASEAN.
Next to Indonesia.
Mm. And you know, that's something that is a positive factor for us, particularly, you know, for our consumer companies, which you know, present quite a good opportunity in this coming months.
But when you talk about the bigger picture in Asia, you've got China's slowdown, and we've got a really close tie with China when it comes to trade. So does that mean investing in export-related companies would be a bit too early right now?
We are I think China exports account for around 11%. Japan, on the other hand, accounts for about 23%. So, and the U.S. about 15%. So China is not that big. The combined exports to Singapore, Hong Kong, and Thailand would be bigger than our exports to China. And the thing is, our exports to China are what? Fruits, you know, things that they
can't
buy.
They're not the intermediate products? It's no longer.
Well, there are some intermediate products like semiconductors and chips, you know. But a good portion of our exports to China are used directly by China consumers.
Kaya pala naubusan na tayo ng mga dried mangoes.
Fruits, yes. You know, because we're the nearest source for these kinds of, like, pineapples. I mean, where do you get pineapples as sweet as Philippines?
So taking all this together, how do we stay equity invested? In which companies? We're talking about interest rate outlook, the peso staying weak, and slowing China. Do we stay with the interest rate sensitive sectors or the consumer companies that will benefit as export grows within the region?
I believe that the things to go for would be those that are heavily consumer dependent and infrastructure. Why? Well, because consumer spending in quarters preceding elections spike in this country, and you know, we're having elections
in
sure
May.
You know this,
of course.
It's a few months
that's
away,
what you know, we're waiting for.
It's 8 months away.
Yes, no?
8 months away. And you know, historically in this country, the quarter immediately preceding the election and the quarter of the election, you see an incremental growth in GDP from the norm of about 1.5%.
Driven by the consumer stocks.
Driven by consumer spending.
Can you name some of the consumer stocks that are worth investing in ahead of the elections?
One of my favorite, of course, is Pure Gold. No, I think that stock is very cheap right now. And it has a nationwide platform, you know, URC, Jollibee, you know. These are consumer stocks that I think.
How about infrastructure stocks? Which ones?
Infrastructure. Well, you have the holding companies. Now you have Metro Pacific there. You have Ayala Corporation has entered into that stream. GT Capital, which is, you know, affiliated with us. GT Capital, they have the power companies. So these are, I think, some of my favorites.
So fully invested, right now, or do we leave
some
in cash?
I'm always conservative. So I would say 15% cash would be excellent.
Right? And the balance of 85% in equities.
I'd go 85% equity at this point in time.
Well, which brings me to the quote that you mentioned in your PowerPoint that you gave me. It's from Paul Samuelson. I don't know if they can pull that up, but I'm going to read it out. I don't know why this is your favorite, but you said investing should be more like waiting for the paint to dry or watch grass grow. Looks like parang sa retirement na to. If you want excitement, take $800 and go to Vegas.
Or to Macau.
I was just going to say to Soler. You don't have to go very far. So does that mean, you know, when you invest, be patient? I mean,
definitely.
85% in equities.
Definitely. It's not as if that you're, I mean, grass grows in about, you know, 3 months' time or even 4 weeks' time.
Okay.
The thing to do is when you invest, don't think that you're going to make the money tomorrow.
Yes.
When you invest, the patience is really what allows you to see a good return. Without patience, you know, the problem with people is that they try to get into the market when the market is strong.
Yeah, exactly.
And then sell when the market is weak. Yeah. So what do? They buy high, sell low. So, you know, obviously they lose money.
That's right. Now,
but the thing to do is, you know, when the market is bad, you have to be a, you know, contrary thinker, a contrarian. When
be
the market's bad, that's when you come in.
Yeah, have
but
a green thumb.
You have to choose the really good ones, you know, the really good stocks, the good picks, the one that will last.
And you just mentioned them, consumers and infrastructure, and make sure you invest with patience.
With patience.
Very good advice on a holiday. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Cathy.
Gus Cosio of Metro Asset, First Metro Asset Management, here in the studio live with us.